Hello and welcome to yet another episode stream. I don't know how to call it nowadays. It's like everything is online. It's an online event organized by GDG Cloud Oslo and GDG Bergen. So my name is Rustam. I am representing GDG Cloud Oslo. And today we have a great pleasure of having Guillaume with us to talk about a very interesting topic. I mean, it's been quite a bit of interest about this topic, about cost optimization on the cloud, especially in Google Cloud. So I think I will put the slides and put your share screen and share it with everyone. And I will also encourage everyone watching this stream live to ask your questions. Write them in the YouTube chat, in the chat window on the side there. And as they come in, I will be jumping back into the stream and asking the questions. Or if that works, I will also wait till the end and ask them as well at some point. So please write your questions and I will be asking them to our speaker. And yeah, like I said, it's my great pleasure to introduce the fellow GDE for cloud as well. So take it away again, as the stage is yours.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, and also a pleasure to be with you in Norway, even if there's a lot of sun and a lot of warm weather here in France. So thank you very much, and today, yes, we will talk about cost and money because it's a very important topic. And yes, I'm a Google Developer Expert on the cloud, also data architect at Accenture. And in fact, I don't know why I'm talking about today, because for me, Norway don't need to care about the money. Why? It's very simple, because Norway is a gold mine. Why I'm talking that? Because when I'm watching the Olympic Games, Norway is in the top with 12 gold medals, and I'm sure you have a lot of gold in your country. But the cloud is not the Olympic Games, and yes, you have to take care of the money in the cloud and not to the Winter Games. So let's go back to the topic and to talk about the cloud. But before talking about the money and stuff like that, we need to understand what the resources in the cloud, what the basics of the cloud, what the pillar of the cloud, and what costs in the cloud. And you can ask yourselves, what are the pillars of the cloud? And in fact, there is three pillars. The pillars are what you find in any data center, because the cloud is not different as any data center. And when you think about a data center, what do you need? Okay, you need servers. And servers, what do you have in servers? You have CPU, memory. Okay, you have you have power to compute. You have disk. Okay, of course. And we have a lot of servers, and we connect those servers between themselves with network, and we need to connect the servers with the external world, with internet. And that is your three pillars. You have a processing power, CPU and memory. You have storage to store your files, to store your structured data in database. And then you have networking to communicate internally or externally your data. And of course, if you have a look to the cloud, and I'm speaking about the clouds in general, or even to your data centers, if you are still on-prem, what are the costs? And the costs are exactly the same. You will pay for the processing, the CPU and the memory that you use. You will pay for the storage that you use and you consume, or you reserve, because sometimes you don't use the full storage, but you reserve an amount of storage and you pay for this reservation. And the network. In the cloud, you pay mainly the egress, the traffic that go out of the cloud, but you pay also for the traffic between the region in the cloud and so on. So you need to pay for the networking. But all the costs, all the level of the importance of the costs are not the same. If you take, for example, globally, if you take €1, $1, yes, €1 for the networking, you will use approximately 10 for the storage and 100 for the processing. What I will say by here is the biggest cost in the cloud is the processing, 10 times less the storage, and 10 times less again the networking. That's why if you have to focus your effort on something, the processing, the CPU, the memory, you need to start to optimize this part to reduce the processing time, the size of the VM, the number of CPUs, the size of the memory, and so on. Then you need to optimize the storage, and at the end, maybe the networking. Of course, it's a roughly estimation. Of course, if you are a Netflix-like or a YouTube-like, you have a lot of videos, and the storage and the egress cost will be very high, and the processing may be less. But it's a global estimation, and according with your use case, of course, this estimation can change accordingly. So if we have a look to the pricing model on Google Cloud, we will have the similar items and inputs that I presented presently. In fact, when you have to use the infrastructure resources, I mean GPUs, CPUs, persistent disk, you pay the resource that you use and the duration that you use. Yeah, something different in the cloud and when you are on-prem, you don't buy the resources. You only rent the resources for a duration. You can use a VM for one day, and when you don't want to use it, you remove the VM from your project and you stop to pay for it. When you are on-prem, you buy a server, and even if you don't use the server, you have both your server and you have still your server in your data center, and you don't know what to do with it if you no longer need it. That's the main difference between the on-prem and the cloud. That's why the notion of duration is very important when you want to optimize things. So for infrastructure, GPU, CPU, disk, you pay for the resource size and the duration that you use the resource. When you talk about serverless, it's also the instance size and the number of instances that you have. And instance size, of course, is the amount of CPU and memory. You have no disk because it's stateless. You have no persistence, no data persistence in serverless products. And because you can scale up and down, you pay per instance. Something very interesting here, that CloudRun, CloudFunction, and App Engine can scale to zero. That means if you have no instance, you have nothing to pay because you have no CPU and no memory reserved in your project. When you talk about cluster, it could be a Kubernetes cluster, it could be a Dataflow cluster, it could be a Dataproc cluster. Of course, a cluster is a cluster of VM, and a VM is an amount of memory and CPU, and you pay for that, for the duration of the cluster. The database is the storage, and the database are different because you pay for the storage that you use, and with BigQuery, cloud logging, or cloud storage, you pay for the exact volume that you use, but also for the data that you process. For example, with BigQuery, you pay for the volume of data that you scan when you perform a query, and with cloud logging, you pay for the data that you ingest in cloud logging. The ingestion is billable on cloud logging. And finally, you have different class of services when you pay per use. That means you pay per message. With PubSub, you pay for the volume of the message and the number of the messages that you have. With Cloud Armor, you pay for the volume of requests that you have and the number of requests that you process with Cloud Armor. with Firestore, okay, you pay for the amount of data that you store in Firestore, but you pay per request to read, write, or delete the data in cache storage. This time it's slightly different because it's mainly a per action. But of course, when you perform a request, what is behind the scene, it's an amount of CPU and memory that you use to perform the request and to get your data, write your data, and so on. So that's the pricing model of Google Cloud, and all the cloud providers have the similar pricing model. And something very important is you pay that even if you misuse the resource. What I will say here is if you forget to turn off the TV when you go to work at the office and you go back at home and you say, oh no, my TV use electricity during all the day, what are you doing? You turn off the TV and that's all, and we pay the electricity bill at the end of the month. And for the cloud, it's the same. If you have a big VM and you forget to turn off the VM, you will pay for it, even if you don't use it, even if you forget to delete it, you will pay for it. That's why the cloud is sometimes scary for the company and the team because they don't really manage how it will cost at the end of the month, because if you are cautious, you won't pay too much. But if you make a mistake, you can have a huge bill, and the financial team prefer to have a flat rate than to have a spike in the billing because they prefer a predictable cost compared to the unpredictable or the spiky cost and so on. So that's why sometimes you will have some issues with your teammate and the management of your company when you go to the cloud because of that model, which is more pay as you use than a flat rate. And that's why also, and we will see that just later, you have a lot of options to commit an amount of resources that we'll use in the cloud. And sometimes companies prefer to have a flat rate and to pay more than the real resources that they need to use. So some companies prefer to pay more but to have a flat rate than to pay less and to have some spike in their billing because they don't like to have unpredictable costs. So now we'll have a look on Google Cloud and on the platform and what you can do to be proactive or reactive when your cost goes too high. The first thing to do, in fact, when you have a project, is to put an alert on a project. You can choose a scope, you can choose a project or a set of projects. Could be interesting. For example, if you have a folder with a folder by a business unit in your company and you have a budget for this business unit per month, it could be great to have an alert on a set of projects. And you can also have an alert on resources or a set of resources. Maybe you want to have an alert on budgets for the analytics component of a project and another for the transactional components, and you want to have a view and alerts on two sets of components in your project. You can use also a time frame. Most of the time you use a monthly time frame, but now you can have a custom time frame. You can have a weekly or a daily time frame. You can also differentiate a budget on the weekday and the weekend. And maybe the consumption is different according to your use case and your business. And finally, you can choose how to be notified. The first way is to send an email to the billing admin, an email to a custom team, a custom group. I don't know, maybe the team project, maybe manager or something like that. you can also publish a message in a Slack or in a PubSub topic. But sometimes you would like to prevent the user to do anything on your project. For that, you have a simple solution is to use IAM permission to restrict the users to the use of a set of products. For example, in your company, you never use Hadoop, MapReduce, Spark, and so on. You say, okay, you will never use Dataproc because it's not our way of working. That's a way to limit anyone to create the Dataproc cluster with 100 VMs and so on. Yes, that's great. But for me, it's not perfect because you limit the creativity or the capacity for the users to try another things, another products, and you limit their freedom to innovate. And sometimes you have something called shadow IT that users create side projects without any restriction, with IAM permission to try something different, and maybe with the data of the company because there is no limitation on their side project than the main project of the company, and you can have that exfiltration and other issues because of that. Personally, I don't like this solution, but you can use it if you want to have a central management of the permission and the data access. Service access. A preferred way is to have custom quotas. What is it? For example, when you create a project, you can have up to 3,600 CPUs that you can use in 20 regions in the world. Not sure that for a development project, you need to have 3,000 CPUs to use, for example, in Asia. Not sure that it's a requirement for a development project. But a user can create a VM or a set of VM with a lot of CPUs in Asia, in Australia, in America, and so on. You don't want that because the user don't need that. But if the user account is compromised, hackers can create a lot of VMs in those region and add Bitcoin miner, for example, in those VMs and to use your billing accounts to mine Bitcoins. And yeah, it could happen, and it happens in a previous company where I worked. That's why it's a real security issue that can happen in your company. So for with the quotas, you can limit the number of resources that you can use in a different region and for different products. For example, for the VM, you can say, okay, you can use only 10 CPU in Europe West 5, or I don't know what the region in Norway or in... so it's not a problem. So you can set an amount of CPU in the region of your choice. And not more. That's why, even in production, if you don't need to have CPUs in Asia or in Australia, no problem. You are limited to only that. You only allow the users to use any product, maybe BigQuery also, because with BigQuery, you can set custom quotas and say to your users, use BigQuery if you want, but you are limited to 1 terabyte per day. And if you use more, you need to wait tomorrow to continue to experiment and to use your query. So be cautious, perform small queries on a small set of data, and don't expense and don't use too much BigQuery to query anything. The bad side of this solution is it's difficult to manage, especially when you have new products. You need to update the quotas of all your projects and all your development projects. And if you have a large company, if you have a lot of scripts to write and the process to perform, to update all the projects and so on. So it's not easy to manage, but for me, it's the best solution to limit the errors and the mistake, or even the compromission and the security issues when you have too much resources in your project. other solution to stop to pay is to stop the resources. And because when you don't use the CPU and you don't use the memory, you will stop to pay at the end. That's why you can schedule how to stop the resources. You can schedule API calls to stop resources. Wait a minute, please. Excuse me, kids are coming back from school and my daughter asked for a hug. So you can use Cloud Scheduler to perform API call to Google Cloud product to stop your resources. You can stop your VMs, you can stop your Cloud SQL instances, you can stop your Kubernetes cluster or to reduce the number of nodes in your Kubernetes cluster. You can stop your data flow jobs and so on. You can perform a lot of things with API calls. Yes, stop and start the resources. You can also create and delete the resources because maybe your Kubernetes cluster is ephemeral or your data cluster is ephemeral. You want to delete it at the end of the day, and you can schedule a creation at the beginning of the day like that the user or the developer go to their project with a fresh data cluster, but you don't pay the cluster during the night or during the weekend when the developer is not here. You can also call custom code. I don't know if you have some things more complex to perform than a simple API call. You can call a Cloud function or a Cloud run, and this Cloud function or Cloud run can perform things more complex with code. A new feature. So yes, it's a new feature. You have the same feature, the scheduling, but for the Google Compute Engine, so the VMs, and the MIG, the Managed Instance Group. Managed Instance Group is a set of VMs managed by Google Cloud to scale up and scale down. You can scale up and scale down according to the traffic, according to the CPU usage. And now you can scale up and scale down your MIG, your Managed Instance Group, with a scheduler. And you can also stop and start your Compute Engine, your VM, with a scheduler. Yes. Another way to view and to be proactive to understand what's happened in your project is to use Recommender. Recommender and its name now Active Assist. In fact, Active Assist is a suite of tools on Google Cloud to help you to understand what's happened in your project. You have recommendation on security, recommendation also on cost or resources that you use or you don't use. And you have recommendation, yes, powered by AI, but especially when you underutilize CPU and memory. As I said in introduction, what costs the most is the CPUs and the memories that you use in the cloud. And if you reduce the CPU and the memory, it could be interesting. But a recommender can also recommend you to increase the CPU and the memory because the VM is over-utilized and you need to increase the size of CPU and memory to be sure that you won't saturate the VM and to have an outage or service issue because of that saturation. You can have also recommendation on the unused IP address because the public IP address that you reserved and you don't use are billable, and that's why you can remove that. You can also remove or have a view on the unattached persistence disk. Persistence disks are disks that you can attach to VM, and you can attach the disk or detach the disk. That's very powerful because you can unattach a disk to a VM and attach it to another VM if you want. That's very powerful. But sometimes you detach a disk and you let the disk like that. The problem is the disk, it's a storage space that you reserve on Google Cloud. And if you use it or don't use it because the space is reserved for you, you will pay what is reserved for you. And if you have a lot of disks, you will pay a lot for nothing. maybe you need this disk because it's a backup disk or snapshot disk, and maybe you need to keep them. But sometimes it's only because you forgot to delete them, and the recommendation help you to remove this garbage resources. And it's new, you have a recommendation on the committed use discount. That means you need to, you, according to your project or your list of projects, because you have a recommendation also as a folder or organization level, you can have a recommendation to commit a number of CPU or memory for 1 year or 3 years to save money up to 70% over 3 years to save money by committing usage of resources for 3 years or 1 year. And you have a recommendation to use this discount. And similarly for the VM, you have a similar recommendation for BigQuery. BigQuery is not, it's not named VM, it's named slots, but a slot is a slice of memory and CPU that perform your request, your, that process your data on BigQuery. And you have also a recommendation on slots and how to optimize the slot reservation on your project. So a recommender is very powerful, and I recommend to have a look on it, look at it. Especially when your project run in production for 3 or 6 or 9 months, because recommender need to have a few times of observation to understand what your project do every month, every day, every hour, to provide you some recommendation. That's why when you are in production and your project is stable, you can start to optimize it and to improve it, especially with the cost optimization. So you can also perform custom code to optimize your projects. Why you need custom code? Because sometimes you need to perform complex things and to process some alerts and alarm. For example, BigQuery overutilization. Why I'm saying that? Because with BigQuery, you can have some quotas, of course, per users, but you won't put some quotas in production, because in production, maybe you can have some issues, but you want to check before the before the alerts, before being an alert on the budget, before paying really the cost on BigQuery, you want to monitor in real time or near real time what is going on BigQuery. And for that, and what we did in a previous company, we sync the logs of BigQuery in BigQuery, and every hour we performed a query in BigQuery to aggregate the usage of each query and each query of each, yeah, to aggregate the bytes build in each query and to see if the usage is too high or is abnormal compared to our ABAC and what we observe daily. It's very important because when you base your alert on the budget, keep in mind that when the budget is updated, it's not in real time. Some products, and especially BigQuery, can take up to 12 hours to send the information to the billing, the number of dollars that you consume on BigQuery. And in 12 hours, you can consume a lot and you can have some issues. And yes, BigQuery can, your billing can go very high in 12 hours. And before being this alert is the alert on budget, you want to do something faster, and it's a way to go faster with a custom code. You can also have a trigger when you are over budget. Because alerts on budget are very good, but when you have an alert, you only send an email, you publish a message in PubSub, and you can cache this message with custom code, but that's all. it's only an alert. You won't stop the project consumption because you reach a level, a threshold in your budget. And something that you can do, that you can catch the alerts with PubSub and perform a custom code. And what we did also in a previous company is to remove the billing accounts on the project to stop the consumption of the project. So when the project is 400% over the budget, we say we keep the billing account and we remove the billing account of the project, and the project stop immediately. Okay, in production it could be dramatic, but you have to it's a matter of a trade-off between continue to pay too much or to stop your activity in production and to understand what's happened and why you go over your budget and you go too high comparing your budget. And it can save you, especially when you reach this limit during the weekend and you have nothing on call, you have nobody on call to perform some actions, and it can save you when you have a bug in your code in production. You have also in Google Cloud some discounts and some built-in discounts. You have the first one, and not very well known, it's the sustained use discount. What is it? Is when you use a VM on Google Cloud, if you let your VM up and running, automatically at the end of the month, you have 30% of discounts. It's like that, it's automatic, in fact, and you have nothing to do for that. And when you have a full-time up and running VM, you have this discount. Of course, if you stop the VM, you will reduce the discount. And I think you need to have your VM up and running 15 days. And after 15 days, you start to have a discount, 5%, 10%, 20%, and at the end of the month, 30%. So now you have to think, should I develop a procedure to stop my VM to save some money, or to let my VM up and running and to have 30% of discount at the end of the month by doing nothing? It's a choice to perform. You have the commit use discount to commit the usage of CPU, GPU, local SSD, and memory for 1 or 3 years. And you commit this usage. You have the BigQuery slots. Also, I also say that you can commit and you have a flat rate on BigQuery. Today with BigQuery, you pay according to the volume of data that you scan in your table. With slots, because you pay the slots, you won't pay the processing twice, and you use the slots that you already paid. And so when you query BigQuery, you pay nothing more than the reserved slots that you have. When you store files in cloud storage, also you pay for the volume that you use, and you have different storage classes. You have to think, when I store a file in storage, will I use it immediately? Will I use it next month? Or maybe a day in the 3 next years? If it's maybe in the 3 next years, it's not important for you to keep in the very hot storage class. If you put it in the cold class or the archive class, it could be enough for you. So according to your use case, your type of files, you can change the storage class and to pay less for the files that you store on a cloud storage. But think about that. When you store your file in a storage class, in the colder storage class, you have nearline, coldline, and archive. You have three cold storage classes. You will start to pay when you read your file. So if you never read your file because it's an legal archiving and you maybe read it a day if you have a check by the government, maybe. So you can put it there. You will never have a control. It's not a problem. But if you could use it, be careful on the more optimized, class that you use. And you have a recommender that now recommend you the best storage class for a type of file. And recommender can help you to make this choice better. But of course, you need to let your file during 1 year or 2 years because to have a good recommendation of recommender, because maybe recommender can't know if the file is for legal archiving or if it will be used later for your normal process. Maybe it's an annual file that you use for your for the financial team or things like that. So last point, you have also nothing to do for that. You have free tiers and on App Engine, Cache Storage, BigQuery, you have 5 terabytes of processing per month. With Cache Storage, you have 10 gigabytes of data. Yes, with Cladrun, you have also a lot of things. With PubSub, I think you have 1 million of messages per month. So you have 22 products where you have free tiers and you have nothing to do for that. It's out of the box. It's an automatic discount for you. And that's why I don't hesitate to use and to try some products with free tier, because it's free when you try them and maybe you can discover excellent use case or new products that can solve issues in your company. You have also some features in Google Cloud that help you to reduce the cost or to optimize the cost. You can set some max limits on some resources. You have quotas, as I said, that it's global to the project, but sometimes on a service, you can set a max limit on a managed instance group. You don't want that your managed instance group scale up to 1,000 of VM. Maybe 10 VM is enough for your managed instance group, and that's the max limit. You also have the Dataflow workers, because we have a cluster of VM and you can say, okay, I need only 10 VM to process my my file. And even if Dataflow want to go to 50 VMs to go faster, you can say, no, I don't want to go faster. I want to limit my cost to 10 VM and that's all. And you have similarly a cluster size with Kubernetes or with Dataproc and any other cluster solution, you can limit that. But also with serverless products like CloudFunction or Cladrun, App Engine, you can say, I don't want more than 10 instances. And even if you have a lot of traffic on your product, on your website, on your service, when you reach the max limit, you can't go over. It's important, this max limit in serverless products, because it's very difficult to know the cost of serverless product at the end of the month, because you pay only when you use it. And if it's a public website, you don't know if you will have a lot of activities, a lot of users, a lot of customers on your website. And that's why your billing is unpredictable. But if you set a max limit, you can say, okay, in the worst case, I never will pay more than this limit. And maybe you can provide this limit, this max billing to the financial team, and they are happy because it's a flat rate. And if you consume and if you use less, they will be happy twice, because you save money and maybe you will have a bonus at the end of the year. You can also use preemptible VM or also spot VM. It's a new way to have a preemptible VM. What is it? It's a discount on the VM, because there is some resources not used on Google Cloud, and Google say you, because nobody use them, you can use them, but for a price lower. But, because of course there is a but, on the preemptible VMs, when Google needs the VMs, he will preempt, he will get the VM, so stop your workloads on the VM and get the CPU and the memory to use it, to use them for a user that will pay the real price for the VM and the CPU, for the CPU and the memory, and not a cheaper discount price that you have. So you can use that for non-critical workflow or job or resumable workloads. It could be interesting. Maybe in Kubernetes, you can have some node pools with standard VM and node pools with preemptible VMs and try to perform your non-critical workloads on the preemptible node pool because it will be more efficient in terms of cost. And finally, you can use the pay-as-you-use services. I talk about the serverless product with Cloudrun, App Engine, Cloud Function, but also with PubSub, with Cloud Scheduler, with Cloud Task, with BigQuery. You have a lot of products that you pay only when you use the service, and it's prevent you to use a VM full-time. If you use a pay-as-you-use services, you use the VM only when you use it and never the night or the weekend when you have nobody in the office or in your company and so on. Of course, maybe your legacy application need to be re-architected to use the pay-as-you-use services. But if you can, or if you design new application, keep that in mind to be the most efficient at the end. And the final slide on the most important or maybe the most impactful solution is to perform some training. To train your employees, to train your colleagues, to empower them to use the cloud. Because most of the time, the user use the cloud and they don't know how it costs exactly. If you train, if you tell them when you use BigQuery, you pay the data that you process. When you use a VM, you pay the duration of the VM when you use it. When you have data scientists and machine learning VM with GPUs, it's the same thing. You will pay the duration that you use the GPUs, and so on. If your employees know the cost of the product, if you train them, I'm sure it will be very efficient at the end. Why? Because the money that the company put in the cloud, the money that the company don't put in the salary, in the bonus, or in the events, and so on. That's why if you save money for the company, maybe they will earn more money at the end of the year. It's not guaranteed, but it's a possibility. Maybe, and yes, we did that. You can rank the project per consumptions. And you can say, okay, this project is the project that use the most and costs the most in the cloud. And month after month, you can also perform a ranking with the saving and the effort of the team to save some resources and cost and to reduce the billing every month. You can see have a reward and maybe a challenge between teams. Maybe a team can help another team. I think it's this one. You have a cross-team review and to have a reward on the team that optimize the most a product, a project, a query. Maybe you can optimize the query in BigQuery to reduce the amount of data that you consume, and maybe to reward an employee or a team because if you save thousands of dollars per month, maybe the team can have a little bit of reward. In addition to that, you can also tell your employees that when you use resources in the cloud, you use power, you use electricity, and to generate and to create electricity, you use CO2. Yes, is that? And the carbon footprint of your applications and the cloud usage is not neutral, is not nothing. And if you reduce the cost, you also reduce your carbon footprint. And maybe for some employees, it's more important to reduce the carbon footprint than to reduce the expenses for the company, because they trust more the planet than the company. And could be also a point of view to take into account to train or to empower the employees when they use the cloud. And that's all for me. I would like to thank you, the GDG Norway, for this invitation. I will be very happy to talk about the costs, how to manage them, how to view them, how to optimize them. And if you have some questions, I'm happy to answer you now, or maybe to answer you on Twitter, on LinkedIn, and so on. Don't.
All right. Thank you very much. It's been really fun to listen to this talk. It's really interesting. Very good. Good insight, good ideas, good thoughts. It's been a great pleasure. Thank you very much. Do we have any questions? Do you have so now Eivind is here with us as well. So the GDG Bergen representative representing GDG Bergen.
So I actually have a question that's kind of been I've been wondering, and probably some other people watching might be wondering. So with GCP, where do you start to kind of figuring out your cost? What is there any tools in GCP for kind of get your where you are now type of overview?
Yes. To start with the billing and to understand what's happened, you need to have an overview on what you spent on Google Cloud, and the cloud billing page is the way to start to view what's happened. And when you understand your metrics and what's happened, now you can start to perform actions. But as any project, and when you talk about billing, but also when you have some metrics in observability and so on, you need to observe what's happened and then take action.
Yeah. Okay. Because I know some people, they export it and put it into BigQuery for kind of processing.
Yes. Yes. It's the best practice to export your data, your Bing data to BigQuery, maybe to create some dashboard on top of that data, and especially also to keep an history of the billing, because on the cloud billing interface, I think you have 12 months or 15 months of history, but not more. Mm-hmm. But if you keep your data in BigQuery, you can keep your data for 10 years or more. And you can also have a view on your evolution of the billing, maybe your action. And you can also share the dashboard with other teams or your manager or things like that. You have a Data Studio dashboard provided by Google. I think you have also a Looker project that you can use if you use Looker to automatically. In fact, you have a predefined dashboard to have a view on your billing when you put your data in BigQuery.
Thank you very much. That's a very good point. I was about to mention that. It's really, really. We have a question. We have a question from Tour. So first, very much enjoyed the talk, and thanks. Have you had any experience with preparing for costs in advance of charges, such as delivering costs from Terraform plans? And additionally, have you worked with exporting and displaying and alerting in Grafana and similar tools?
To plan cost with Terraform, I already view some project or product that do that. Mm. But it's easy when you talk about VMs, because when you deploy a VM, you know the cost of the VM at the end of the month, so it's perfect. But it's only for the VMs, and when I talk to the VMs, it's also with GKE, maybe with Dataflow, maybe with Dataproc, because you know the size of your cluster, your size of your VM. When you talk about serverless, especially with BigQuery, with PubSub, with CloudRun, with CloudFunction, it depends. And yeah, maybe you can have some insights with this kind of tools, but it's not really efficient when you use serverless products. And honestly, I'm a big fan of serverless products and not very a big fan of infrastructure. That's why, yes, I already saw those products, but I never use them.
Yeah. And then I've seen. Go ahead.
No. It was for the second part of the question. Go ahead.
No, I was just was about to mention one of the things that I've seen. It's called, I think, infracost.io. It's the infrastructure and Terraform. It kind of integrates into Terraform. It's supposed to show you the expected costs. Of course, it's kind of estimates and everything. But I've heard of this tool. I've seen this tool, but I haven't had any experience with it. So I just thought to mention that that was it. So back to you.
Yeah. Yes, it is. Thank you. Just for the second part of the question, how to export and display the alerts in Grafana. I think it's an alert on the budget. In fact, what we did to have a graph with the Data Studio, in fact, similar to Grafana, to have a graph of alerts, we raise an alert on budget. And we publish a message in PubSub, and with PubSub, we have a CLED function, a simple CLED function that performs a log, and we write a log according to the alerts, and that's all. And after, we build a dashboard on that logs, because we also sync the logs in BigQuery, but you can also write the alerts in BigQuery and then to create a dashboard on BigQuery if you want. In fact, it's only to log something, the alert, and you can do that automatically with cloud alerting, with cloud billing that raises an alert. That's why you need to get the alert with cloud function and then to log the function in cloud logging or in BigQuery and to create a dashboard on that.
One more thing I kind of just came up to my head that I thought maybe it would be worth mentioning. If you are in the planning stage of the costs and like how, what you want to do and the kind of in the architecting and planning stage, that might be a good idea to look into the calculator. So pricing calculator that is available on Google Cloud website as well. So that might give you a kind of an idea of how much it possibly will cost. It's not automated, it's a manual process, but it will still give you some kind of, you know, feeling of what it might be.
Yes, it's a solution to have a roughly estimation. You can say, okay, I'm sure at the end of the month, I will pay the amount provided by the estimator. Why? Because you have some costs that you don't know. For example, the egress cost is very difficult to know the egress cost. Maybe the storage also, you don't know exactly how many files we store in cloud storage. And again, when you use serverless products, you don't really know how you will use them. So that's a good tool to estimate roughly to 20% the cost of your project, but you can't say exactly the billing at the end of the month.
Absolutely. That's a very good point. Do we have any other questions? Anything from you, Evan?
No, any funny cloud cost related stories to share, like funny mishaps? No.
A word about the quotas at the beginning, because I'll talk about the quotas. A company that I know has a leakage in their service account key files. And in one weekend, the leakage cost $600,000 in Bitcoin miner VMs because of this leakage, and because there is no quotas on the development project because it was a leakage in notebook. Yes, it's not important, but the project has not quotas on the VMs, and a lot of VM, I think it was 3,000 VMs created in the weekend to perform Bitcoin mining, and it cost a lot in only one weekend. And so be careful about the quotas. The same thing also in the same company a few months before. It was one data scientist consume $50,000 in one day on BigQuery because he performed query on terabyte of data all the day long. And that's why quotas are very important to limit the resources.
And also might be a very, very good idea just to mention, it's a bit off topic, but it might be a good idea to mention that, you know, be careful with your, keys and your authentication files that you might come to, to submit to some kind of a GitHub repository or somewhere, even though you deleted there, it's still there. So make sure that you change and rotate your keys if that happens, because if not, things like that might happen, like I mentioned, with all the VMs and everything.
That's why errors can happen and you can mitigate them with quotas, but of course if you can prevent the mistake and the security errors, it could be great.
So as a final thought, is there like a three main points that you want to our listeners and people watching to kind of leave this talk with? I mean, three main things, well, at least three things that they might think about when it comes to costs, what that might be from your point of view.
Yeah. The first things when you start a project, a personal project, or also a project in your company, is to set an alert on your budget. To have at least an email when you reach a threshold. Yes, just that. It's the minimum for each project. Then, of course, set some quotas to limit the resource usage. And at the end, my favorite topic is serverless. Use pay-as-you-use products. For two reasons, it's when you don't use the resources in serverless, you pay nothing. And if you pay nothing, the resources can be used by others and you share the same resources, the same pool of resources. And like that, I think you save money, you save the planet. Because when you use a VM only two hours per day, it's a waste of resources. And if you use serverless resources, it's better for you, your money, for the planet, and everybody.
Can you enforce quotas in an organization in GCP?
No. You enforce the quotas per project, and that's why it's difficult to manage. Because when you want to change the quotas, you need to update all the projects in your companies, and sometimes you have a lot of projects, and it could take time for that. Yeah.
As a kind of one bonus thing, I would like to mention that there is a preview for something called carbon footprint on GCP that will actually give you an idea of how much carbon footprint, because you mentioned that part already in your talk, but I kind of want to emphasize that there is actually a thing you can attach or you can use on GCP that will give you an idea of how much carbon footprint and, from the sustainability point of view, how much you're actually using and how you can adjust and make things. And one more thing, if I may add, is going to be to have a look at the free tiers and free quotas for monthly or once in a time and stuff like that, because those will also help you quite a bit with the cost if you use them correctly. So that's kind of a few bonus things from my side. But thank you very much for the great questions. Thank you for great answers. Thank you for the great talk. And we really hope to see you again at some point. And hopefully, fingers crossed, that we'll be able to do it in more kind of in-person events at some point. We'll see how that will go and when that will happen. But, we're still keeping fingers crossed and hoping for that.
Yes, yeah. It could be great. And I will share the slide on Twitter, so don't hesitate to view them or to use them if you want to review them and to use them also in your company if you want, no problem.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you.
I guess, yes, I guess that will be all from me. I'll say thank you. Even any final words?
No, I think you summed it up pretty well. So thank you for listening, everyone.
Thank you all. Bye-bye. We'll see you soon.
Thank you. Goodbye.